Thank you everyone for joining us today for this webinar on in-flight connectivity and its recovery options after a tough year due mainly to the COVID-19 crisis and as well as the crisis impacts on the aviation industry worldwide. For today's session, we will have a look through the impacts on both the commercial and business aviation markets following the COVID-19 outbreak. Then a look on the transformation of the ecosystem that was initiated in the recent years and that has been accelerated in this year, 2020. We'll also talk about the recent and upcoming technology improvements in the in-flight connectivity industry. And finally, we will elaborate on the potential market recovery scenarios that can be anticipated depending on several factors. Let's start by having a look at how the commercial aviation market has been impacted so far by the COVID-19 outbreak. A good indicator to see the dynamics of the aviation market is the revenue passenger kilometer, or RPK, which measures the volume of passengers carried by airlines. By looking at the evolution of this indicator over the past years and the forecast for 2020, we clearly see that the IATA is expecting a severe decrease. The reason for this situation and are directly linked to the COVID-19 outbreak that have struck almost the entire world. Measures taken by many countries to limit the propagation of the virus, such as imposing a lockdown or closing the borders, directly led thousands of aircraft to remain on the ground, which is an unprecedented situation. All of those unused aircraft have a heavy financial impact for airlines, which are currently burning cash. Therefore, the priority for the airlines is today to avoid unnecessary or unessential costs. And in-flight connectivity is one service, or might be one service, that can be cut by some airlines in order to save costs. If we now look ahead, well, in the short term, the situation is not bright. The latest estimates from the IATA, as we can see on the graph, reflect that the recovery is actually slower than expected, mostly due to the rise of new COVID-19 cases in many countries since 1 or 2 months, leading to a stagnation in the small recovery that was experienced during summer. Actually, by looking deeper, we note that dynamics are significantly different between domestic and international flights. Indeed, domestic flights are less impacted by the restriction I mentioned already, like borders closing. So this is clearly a driver for recovery for the domestic flight. However, in a recent publication, IATA expects the airlines to burn cash through until 2022. So due to this tough financial situation, and depending on how long the virus will be circulating, and measure also will be taken by governments, we could experience a diminution of the airline's fleet size due to early retirement of aircraft or even cancellation or postponement of new aircraft deliveries. Now, how the business aviation market is reacting to the situation? Well, after a successful year in 2019, the business aviation market is slowed down by the pandemic, with an estimated 40 to 45% decrease in the number of new aircraft deliveries in 2020. The business jet addressable market is expected to come back to pre-COVID state of deliveries, of aircraft deliveries by 2023 or 2024. Whereas turboprop business aircraft are expected to attain this number by 2025 to 2026 due to the decreased demand in turboprop business jets. Moreover, the retirement of business jet and turboprops are expected to accelerate in the near term, owing to the pandemic and the economic downturn that will be induced by the pandemic, of course. In the longer term, however, the number of large business jets should experience a growth at around 5% CAGR until 2029, so over the next decade. And this will in turn drive connectivity demand, as larger aircraft require more capacity on average. Meanwhile, small business jets will most likely witness the lowest growth rate for the decade, has increased in the scraping of the small jets than the deliveries is expected in the near future. Now, on the regional scale, the North American market should continue to represent the lion's share of global business aircraft, with an essentially constant 60% of the fleet in average. And on the other hand, Europe and Latin America are forecasted to lose market share to the emerging Asia-Pacific region, where growth in business aviation should take up again in a few years. The number of business aircraft in this region is expected to almost double over the next decade. So to sum up, business aviation is the key when speed, efficiency, flexibility, and safety also are really forerunners. In the first couple of months of the pandemic, the demand was high due to the nature of air travel business aviation provides. The demand went down as nations started closing their borders for international air travel. The demand is expected to be higher as the national, so the demand is expected to be higher as the national borders reopen. And also the shortage in the available aircraft for charter is expected as the owners of the business jets might be reluctant to share the aircraft. And that obviously may cause a significant gap between demand and supply. Now, how the IFC ecosystem is reacting to this situation? And more generally also, what are the main trends in this ecosystem? Well, first of all, in the past few years, we have observed an increasing number of connected aircraft throughout the world. And as the only region providing connectivity through air-to-ground technology before 2019 was North America, the newly connected aircraft in the other parts of the world were connected through VSAT technology. However, even in the US, a decreasing number of air-to-ground connected aircraft has been experienced. If we look on the VSAT side, while most of the aircraft are connected through Ku-band, the Ka band is becoming more and more popular. And this trend is partly driven by the Global Express service of Inmarsat, for example. But what was notable in the market recently was the fragmentation of the service providers and the intensifying competition among them. Market consolidation was awaited by a number of actors and observers, and COVID-19 outbreak has initiated the movement. Vertical integration of some satellite operators, following the example of Viasat, is also anticipated. On the ATG market now, Gogo, the global leader and the only supplier in North America, has declared in August, as you might know, its intention to sell its commercial aviation division. And Intelsat, despite its Chapter 11 situation, decided to buy it. Which is an example of vertical integration. Moreover, as Intelsat is one of Gogo's capacity suppliers currently, some economies of scale might be foreseen. Now, another stakeholder in the IFC market, which is currently restructuring under Chapter 11, is the service provider Global Eagle. And while its strategy relies on a multi-band offering with both Ku and Ka bands, some other service providers, like Panasonic, for example, are more focused on a Ku band solution. However, if in the case of Panasonic, they are trying to diversify recently through, for example, a partnership with Inmarsat by distributing Global Express services in Ka band this time. So for business aircraft, we talked about commercial aviation. Now for business aircraft, the situation is different. A small part of the business jets are connected through VSAT technology, and the vast majority of them are connected through MSS solutions. Moreover, as the business aviation market is much more developed in North America, the ATG technology is a good competitor to VSAT there. Indeed, for example, ATG equipment is smaller and cheaper, which is obviously not negligible, especially on aircraft that are smaller than the commercial aviation aircraft. But let's say that the transformation of this ecosystem is not only happening on the service provider side. The capacity supply is also experiencing and expecting significant changes. And since a few years, high throughput satellites, or HTS, are launched and are adding a significant amount of additional capacity. However, satellite operators are actively working to launch very high throughput satellites, and several new entrants are racing, as you might have heard, for the NGSO constellation competition. The objective of all those systems is to offer more capacity at a much lower cost per bit. And they are consequently expected to be a key factor in the rollout of connectivity services worldwide. However, the amount of capacity that will be allocated to the aero market in the future is highly uncertain because it depends on the decisions of a small number of operators. And with OneWeb, for example, filing for Chapter 11 in April 2020, and the COVID outbreak above all that, many uncertainty factors are being added to the equation. And on top of the risks from constellation rollouts, bankruptcies, and takeovers. Overall, let's say that the HTS capacity allocated for the aero market should represent by 2025 less than 10% of the total used HTS capacity worldwide. So for the other segments. Transformation also occurs now on the terminal side, and despite being already highly consolidated, the IFC modem market experienced more consolidation in 2019 with ST Engineering acquiring NewTek, and therefore placing two former competitors, NewTek and iDirect, under the same umbrella. But in addition to these market dynamics, some technological improvements are also underway. On the satellite infrastructure, to begin with, we have all heard of the different projects of low Earth orbit constellations, or NGSO constellation, or non-geostationary constellation. In addition to pure additional capacity, this type of satellite asset is looking really promising for in-flight connectivity, as enhanced capabilities will be possible thanks to an improved latency. We are talking, for example, here of a latency of around 10 milliseconds for a LEO satellite against 250 to 300 milliseconds for a GEO satellite. Coverage then can either be an advantage or not, depending on if the constellation is covering the poles or not. Now, with a significantly lower cost per bit in an already oversupplied market, especially, those projects are expected to put pressure on capacity prices for the profit of service providers. Still, not every constellation operator shows interest for the aero connectivity market, like SpaceX and Amazon, for example, which did not show any interest publicly yet. Moreover, the extremely high capex requirement and the need for recurring external financing finally led some projects to fail, like LeoSat last year, or bankruptcy, like OneWeb in 2020. So this uncertainty might delay the entry in service for some projects. Then the development of terminal associated with this new type of capacity and the obtention of all the regulatory authorization, like STCs, that are certificates that are allowing the equipment on certain types of aircraft, for example, are on the critical path in order to make this technology accessible for in-flight connectivity rapidly. Now, another technology improvement concerning satellites is the digitally processed payload. So instead of having onboard transponder processing, data processing a fixed portion of signal, transponders will be able to adjust themselves digitally or electronically to process the necessary portion of signal. The objective is to dynamically allocate the capacity where it is needed the most, This technology, associated with beamforming capabilities, offer an optimal coverage of the busiest airline routes, and that will help optimizing the cost efficiency of future satellite systems. Now, all types of satellite systems will benefit from this technology, even the geostationary geosystems. So one goal here is really the improvement of the customer experience, obviously. Now, if we stay on the satellite connectivity side, a technology improvement is awaited on the antenna market before talking about ATG, namely the electronically steered antenna. So this type of antenna have many advantages over conventional mechanically steered antennas. For example, the lower drag due to low profile and the absence of moving parts that help the electronically steered antenna win, let's say, over the bulky structure offered by mechanically steered antenna. However, those antennas still present several challenges. For example, the technology is unable to perform efficiently at higher latitudes, especially when the service is provided through GEO satellites. And presently, the electronically steered antennas are more expensive than the mechanical antennas. So in that way, constant efforts are being taken by the OEMs to reduce the costs of the systems. And technology-wise, the variation in weather condition during a flight had some difficulty to system design, and the power requirement is very high for electronically steered antenna. So that leads to high operating temperatures. Finally, in the last 10 years, many experienced companies, as well as new entrants in the antenna manufacturing, have invested in the development of this new type of antenna. So service providers are also involved in this process, and that ensures the future of electronically steered antenna in the aero industry. Some of the main partnerships, for example, include Gogo's involvement in the development of Phasor solution, Inmarsat's partnership with SkyMeta, Panasonic's involvement with Boeing, and Collins Aerospace with OneWeb. But of course, due to OneWeb and Phasor's bankruptcies in 2020, a delay in the product timeline is expected for both companies. Now, by looking at the air-to-ground technology, so the next generation has been under development by Gogo since almost 5 years now, and well, have some share some similarities with the system developed by Smart Sky Networks. So the next gen ATG service will use beamforming towards the aircraft, which will offer an adequate isolation and an efficient aircraft separation, and that will give access to the aircraft for an increased peak data rate. It also, of course, prevents interference between the systems. Now, how will these improvements help the recovery of the market? First of all, on the commercial aviation market, and well, especially as the IFC market is directly dependent of the aviation market and the traffic, we need to firstly forecast that part. So on a methodology note, given the extraordinary circumstances of the sanitary crisis of this year and its direct and indirect impacts of the aero market, we designed our projections of the market according to two scenarios, one low case and one high case scenario. So those two scenarios are here to mitigate the risk of deviating from reality when looking at the future in such uncertain time, obviously. The main difference between the low and the high case are the projections for aviation-specific indicators like passenger load factor, available seat kilometers, or PLF and ASK, and the projected number of operational airplanes and also connected terminals. Some IFC-specific indicators like the take rate are also considered. So in the high case scenario, we assume the return to 2019 levels around late 2022 to 2023, whereas in the low case scenario, we assume the return to those levels by 2024, thus impacting connectivity usage. In both cases, we excluded the possibility of a second or third COVID wave, but we accounted for a traffic reduction induced by the borders closing and the consumer behavior influenced by those directives. Such practices are likely to last until the end of the pandemic risks, unfortunately. The behavior of airlines is also accounted for, especially their fleet management strategy to reduce their operating expense, as I mentioned earlier. Whether they retire or or store in the long term a portion of their fleet, that will have an impact on the global fleet and their preparation to get their aircraft connected in the future. Other indirect effects are not considered, such as anti-air travel measures. So, for instance, during the summer, France was thinking about forbidding flights under 2 hours with a suitable train connections. Thus, that would, of course, reduce the local air traffic. So now, for commercial aviation, the high-case scenario, so which is the solid curve, I forgot to mention, would see a fast recovery thanks to the lift of international travel ban. Indeed, we assume that global air travel would return to pre-crisis levels by late 2022, as I mentioned, and the economic impact on airlines would be relatively limited. We anticipate a few bankruptcies of those airlines, and thus a moderate decrease in the total number of aircraft. We anticipate almost no additional retirements of equipped aircraft aside from the organic ones. Capacity lists from satellite operators to service providers should remain relatively stable, although the capacity used for 2020 should plunge, obviously. This is due to the relative rigid nature of contracts, and this rigidity might be questioned by service providers in the aftermath, let's say, of the crisis, maybe orienting negotiation towards more agile and flexible capacity contracts. Sorry. So on the other hand, in the low case scenario, which is the dotted curve, we assume that the economic and sanitary crisis would lead to many airline bankruptcies. So we modelized a severe impact on the commercial air travel market, leading to several airline bankruptcies and a decrease in the total number of aircraft in operation. Connectivity services will suffer from lower fill rates, thus decreasing the total capacity used. And satellite operator revenue should get back to 2019 levels during 2023. So the longer the market takes to return to a pre-crisis level, the deeper the impact will be and the longer it will take to resolve them. This explains the differential between the two scenarios. Resorbing the losses induced by the crisis will be a difficult task for airlines, obviously, even with governmental aid packages. Now, on the business aviation side, we assume that the market is comparatively less affected than the commercial aviation market for the following reasons. First of all, it provides means of social distancing from airport check-ins to air travel. And then it allows more personalized journeys from smaller airports and non-scheduled operations. So as we understand that the business aircraft do not fly as scheduled flights, we assume the number of equipped aircraft in use would differ in the coming years and would represent the traffic in both scenarios. So in the high case scenario, so the solid curve, we assumed a momentary growth in the usage of the business aircraft in the multiple region of the world, especially for intra-regional travel, due to the conveniences provided by the business aircraft, like social distancing, airport closing times, etc. And it's interesting to note that multiple service providers received a positive response for the connectivity need for the business aviation segment in the Q2 2020. And some of the service providers, following that, have enhanced their connectivity offerings for this market. For the low-case scenario, the growth here is considered more linear over the near future due to border closure being maintained for a while. And it shall surpass pre-COVID statistics from 2023 onwards. In both cases, growth will mainly be driven by the increasing penetration of visa-based solutions. Despite MSS still being the predominant solution, mainly due, of course, to a lower price, Its limited bandwidth makes it comparatively less attractive. So business jet operators who generally want to provide high quality services to their passengers will therefore increasingly rely on VSAT, especially for new installations. So now to summarize what we just said. Clearly, the COVID-19 outbreak has hammered the aviation market and consequently the in-flight connectivity market as well, with a drop in terminal installation and data usage. Then in the short term, like the next 2 to 3 years, due to cost cutting from the airlines, we anticipate a stagnation or maybe a small decrease in the total number of connected aircraft. However, in the long term, growth is expected to come back, hopefully. As the evolution of the situation is for the aviation market is highly uncertain, as I mentioned, over the next few months, the growth amplitude over the next decade is to be confirmed because it will be highly impacted by how the next few months will be. So that's, in a sense, the purpose of the two scenarios that we have shown you today. Then, once the air traffic will resume, one of the growth drivers for the IFC market will be the massive amount of next-generation satellite capacities that will come operational in the next 2 to 3 years. And on the ATG side, so the air-to-ground side, the business aviation market, is a market with more potential thanks to the arrival of new entrants like Smart Sky Network, for example. Finally, we can say that the IFC market will be pretty dynamic with profound changes in the ecosystem in the years to come, and that will be valid throughout the entire value chain. So, that's what we could say about the recovery possibilities on the in-flight connectivity market. So thanks for having listened to me, and well, I hope you enjoyed it. So Alexandra, I leave you the mic.
Thank you, Xavier, for this presentation. And indeed, we're starting the Q&A session now. We're going to take about 10 minutes for that to take a couple of questions from the audience. So if you have not asked your question yet, please do use the Q&A button to ask it. Let me get into this question and Q&A, Xavier. You mentioned at the beginning that Gogo, which is an ATG leader, is selling their commercial aviation division. Is this a sign perhaps that ATG is becoming perhaps less popular, or is just a market strategy for them to focus more on the business market?
So there is two things here. I think first of all about Gogo. Indeed, as we said, ATG is much more popular for business aviation, and we see that in the past 3 years, ATG, the number of connected aircraft through ATG has been decreasing slightly, which might be a reason for Gogo to leave their commercial aviation division. However, we should not forget that Gogo is also providing satellite connectivity through satellites. And in that respect, it's very interesting for Intelsat, a supplier of Gogo for satellite capacity, and that might be interesting for Intelsat to make economies of scale, as I mentioned, over the Gogo current Gogo Coco customers through satellites. So I think we could analyze that in this way for the two actors.
Thank you, Xavier, for that answer. Another question coming in is perhaps looking at more on the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic and on the prices, and especially for cost, for megabytes, from an airline's perspective, but well as on capacity prices. If you can perhaps share a few notes or ideas on how do you see the evolution on prices?
So, as we talked about the different technology improvement or new entrants that will come in the next 5 years or so, with very high throughput satellites, with NGSO constellation, digitally processed payload. All that will have one effect, which is to lower the cost per bit. So definitely here, those new technologies will put pressure on the prices of the, let's say, the legacy or the former generation of satellites, of satellite capacity especially. And we would logically see a decrease in the capacity prices. Of course, that will be emphasized by the fact that, especially for the LEO constellation, there is, as we mentioned, a number of projects currently, and there might be some consolidation, let's say, in the few years after the first constellation will be live. So that competition will benefit, let's say, the service providers for the capacity lease that they are doing. And behind that, the service providers might also benefit from that by implementing more value-added services for the end users. So that would be one trend that we are seeing.
Mm. You've mentioned also, because we've got it to a bit, and you mentioned the new satellite constellations that are coming out. One of the questions that actually connects to this is whether, from your point of view, do you see the rise of NGSO constellations as a driver for the development or the requirement of electronically steered antennas due to the need for higher switching speeds?
So, of course, the electronic steered antenna have several advantages. So the low profile and of course, a better, let's say, better efficiency when getting the satellite capacity, the satellite signal. So in that respect, let's say, adding electronically steered antenna with NGSO constellations, which will provide lower latency and higher connectivity, are let's say a good combo. to get better service for improved service for the end users. However, as I mentioned, both the terminals that are currently being developed by the NGSO constellations operators and the antenna manufacturers for the electronically steered antenna, well, very few of them are ready at the moment to enter the market and to be operational. So there is a huge work that are conducted by those players on getting the terminals ready, getting the terminals approved with all the regulations, regulatory authorizations. So that's a challenge there, I think, for them. Mm.
And perhaps also staying on the electronically steered antennas topic, have we looked perhaps at our estimations in terms of when we'll be expecting for these to start operational services, and whether in our report we have taken a look at the next 10 years of these antennas and their development towards either the commercial aviation or the business aviation market?
Yeah, so we have indeed in our report we have make a small focus on that very specific product. So we can see that there are some companies that are more advanced than others. The earliest announcements that were made for electronically steered available is in the end of middle of 2021. So that's that would be for the very first entrance. Then a number of the different antenna manufacturers are working on it, and that will follow in the next, let's say, 2 to 3 years. we should see a good number of competitor products going out.
Thank you for that, Xavier. And perhaps I'm looking at the time here, and I'm just going to take a last question. When we look perhaps at the, not just at the COVID impact, but also perhaps in a certain way, one could say that this could be a time for also for innovation to happen. Have you noticed perhaps within the face of these challenges, whether the IFEC industry has been coming up or looking towards more more innovation, or perhaps focusing more on new technologies or new developments to kind of balance out the negative impacts?
First of all, as I mentioned, the BAFC market is highly dependent on the aviation industry. So, of course, all the IFC players are really looking at how the IFC market is going and when it can resume, because that's key for them. Not in their hands. What they can do, as I mentioned, especially for the service providers, is when we are talking about capacity contracts with leasing capacity contracts with satellite operators, we should see, and it has started to happen, some renegotiation between service providers and satellite operators, maybe trying to lower their engagement. In duration, in quantity of transponder, of capacity. So unfortunately for service providers, it's also, they are suffering from that, definitely. And that's their main reaction, let's say.